Nice to be here to discuss with two people out here who have been a great motivation to the kind of industries they've been working with. One is Mr. George Varghese, who is the director of GM and who's been instrumental in the education space for a long time. Then we have with us Shankaran Chettur, who is the director and CEO of Veloces Consulting, who has been bringing technology at affordable cost to educational institutions. So this is a very special episode for Shades, which we call it Shades Special, because these are people who have made a mark and have done something immense, which is very important for youth across the country and in the world to think for themselves to do what they need to do. So without much ado, let me just start off with asking some very fundamental questions about what did we all do to get to where we are today in life and society and in our careers. So let me start off with Mr. George. What is that which motivated you to get into the education segment in the first place?
In a single word, non-monotonous, non-video. Basically, I come from a pharma background, which had very mundane work style. From there, if you compare, it's absolutely every day is new. Every day is challenging. Every day is a new. I don't want to put in issues there, but a new challenge that we face, and that's why I call it. It's not without monotony, the system works. Be it education, training has a different world altogether. Education, there is no monotony at all. So that was the first inspiration that I had. But said that, I started the career in training, then came into education.
Okay. So, as an addition to whatever we spoke now, what do you think is one single factor which is kind of missing in today's youth, where you feel, apart from academics that is, where you feel we as educationists or as enablers are not doing the right things to get to understand youth? Or is it that the systems are so rigid that we are not able to get out of that mold?
We may not have a specific and a clear answer to that, but still, overall picture, we have failed. I would not tell we as when we call it we, it is the I would have to have the parental fraternity also,
yes,
in that,
yes,
canvas, telling that building good attitude in the student is, we are somewhere it's lost.
Okay.
Otherwise, the thought process of a student at this time of these years has deteriorated if you take back a decade back. So probably somewhere we have lost in that the upbringing side. Maybe the school, early the schooling was a little different. Everyone had a teacher, a student relationship was different.
Correct.
So
correct.
Probably those were the reasons attitudes are not built in the right shape. And that's
very evident.
Very evident in the
current scenario.
And that's not only evident, and that's been exhibited more easily.
I see.
Evident is one part of it, and they put it as a verb in the next part of it.
Okay.
So that becomes a little difficult to handle.
Okay, now going on to a similar kind of a scenario where we have Mr. Shankaran with his years of experience from vocational training institute background and then getting into schools as a passion and getting to empower more than 200 plus schools in the country. So, and more so when you get aligned to these kids, end of the day, it is the students who have to benefit. Institutions and all of us are just enablers as such. So, I see a lot of change from youth coming in today, even children, where they come with a lot of information. But is it knowledge? One question. The additional question to that is the enthusiasm as what they project on social media. Is it the same even in institutions and in their lives with the kids, that is?
If you look at what's the children in school and maybe the extension to colleges.
Yes.
I think the world which we lived in, where we were school children and we went into college, is totally different. I mean, today with internet and technologies and, you know, the information which you are rightly speaking. Students have access to information.
Correct.
And whether it's knowledge. I mean, the teacher's role mostly in schools from being a teacher is now moving to a mentor, where how to use the knowledge and adapt the knowledge. And that's exactly the kind of a role which teacher needs to do. So that's when there is a gap between that school where a teacher plays the role of a normal teacher, which used to be the
earlier,
you know, good old way a teacher used to work, to a role of a mentor. If whenever there is a conflict happening there in a education system, that's where you find students sometimes misuse information, don't really show the same kind of a passion which they might show in a social media to what it is. So if we channelize this information with teacher playing a mentor role and things like that, I think today the children are having huge opportunities.
Yes.
There is a huge potential which we can't even imagine. I mean, I'm sure that most of the students, I mean, in today's world, you must be aware that, you know, that there is an 8th standard student who happened to be a CEO of a company, CEO and CEO, Kumar and Brothers.
Correct.
Which is one thing which, when we were in schools, we never even thought about it.
Yes.
So those are opportunities which have been created with this information world. All what is required is to really channelize that, and that's where, you know, that's where from the education industry, from the training, vocational training industry, we thought this is where a huge opportunity lies. If we can create a real kind of a platform within a school where this can actually happen, it's going to be a real transformation. I mean, we are all living in a world of uncertainty. We do not know how we are going to eat tomorrow, whether Uber Eats is going to deliver or something else is going to come. It's a very unpredictable world, and students need to get adapted to an even more unpredictable world when they really come out.
That's true.
And we need to prepare those children for that kind of a world.
Yeah.
So I'm sure there's a lot of work which is needed in that, and IT and technology companies and, you know, organizations which are working there with, you know, those kinds of 21st century skills to be imbibed into children is a huge opportunity which is there.
Sure. And so am I right in saying that what you see on social media as their profiles of a youth also directly reflects in their lives as well, in their own way, though may not be their, in the way their parents or their adults, elders see it. But I think from their point of view,
that's,
they are seeing the world the way it is to be.
Correct.
Correct? Yeah, okay. So again, coming back to Mr. George, just wanted to know, you know, in terms of your own life, what is that you can, you know, kind of relate to? When you were, I mean, when we all have come through the same, see, the good thing with, say, education today is that we have all in some form or the other been through the systems. Therefore, we are here sitting to discuss today this topic, right? So, what's one thing which used to, and this would be a common question to both of you, what would be one thing which we really miss? Even I also have my own thoughts on that. What we went through as students and from our kind of education systems, where we had 60 students in a class and stuff like that. But then we didn't lose out on the essence of many things in our life. Because today when we look back, we gained a lot of things beyond academics. I'm talking, today we are talking about life skilling and, you know, future skills and outbound and all that. But then having said that, those days those terminologies were not there. But we were better prepared to life, I think, because we have gone through almost 5 decades of our life. So what is that you feel, you know, something which we went through and which you believe should still have continued, and which we still, if not continued, it's good to reintroduce something like that. A value-based kind of a thing.
Yeah. Probably even, again, it takes a long time, but still, one is that the values have deteriorated because of the nucleus family system. It's not because we have gone back into a system where we are a very tiny unit. Okay. I mean, suddenly when you told, I mean, I still remember of an instance where when I studied in a town back in Kerala, so in that, in the hostel, I was in the first standard, second standard, I don't remember exactly. I had a small wound on my leg. Okay, so very, when you spoke, thinking of life skills. So the wound, technically I didn't tell anyone. And I know that the wound happened because I got a cut with a nail. Okay. Now it has started to boil up, and pus formation is there. What do I do? And I'm in the hospital. And we are one of the hostels, very premium hostel in the district.
Okay.
It's one of the oldest schools of in Kerala. So, it's a very small community. So we, as a young boy, I never bothered, kept on playing. Evening, what we do? Open the tap, put your leg there.
Sand there.
That's it. Mat goes over and out. It's clean. I mean, technically, we didn't even go for a TT. Logically, we had to do it.
Correct.
But we didn't do it.
Yeah.
We finished our work. Everything said and done. What next we did to do? We knew that, we have heard of that. There is a plant which grows nearby. In Kerala, we call it communist pacha.
Hmm.
It's a green colored stuff. Just take it, rub it on your hand, put it on the wound. That's it. So who taught us that? That is life skilling.
That's right.
Today, probably all three of us have elderly kids. Ask them, I have a doubt whether they will do it.
Yeah.
They will not even know about it.
Yeah.
So what are we missing? That's the essence of life is missed out.
Yeah.
They would know how to, probably they might not even think of taking up a band-aid and putting it sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the difference that the life had given us basically at that point of time.
Yeah.
Not an example, it's probably, these are lessons that we
learned. That's a life lesson.
Life lesson. Suddenly when you told, I just remember that. But there could be hundreds of instances like that.
Correct.
Hundreds of instances like that.
Correct.
When we are made stronger,
yes.
When I remember only one day I cried in the hostel after my mother left. Just a time.
Mm-hmm.
Second time I'm not in my memory is not there.
Yeah.
Maybe I've cried. I have no idea on that. But
right.
In my memory, one day I have cried standing on the, it's on the main road. I stood there and I cried. That's it. I don't think I ever
got into a situation like that.
Because she left.
Left.
Okay. But still then, these are all things that, you know. But I still remember my brother, at an young age, he had a tough time at the hostel.
Mm-hmm.
Every day,
Finding it difficult to cope.
When he cries, an elder brother has no other choice to cry along with him. So I have also cried. But I felt this, the difficulty that he was going through. So as years went by, so the change happened.
Yes.
So correct. That's where the thing is.
So I think that there is a missing link then. So which means today,
we're not able to create that missing link. We can't fill that up. It's not an easy thing to fill.
Mm-hmm.
But said that, the line I started was the family's setup.
Mm.
We may not be able to come back into the same system, but we as parents, I think, have a lot of responsibility towards the kids. I think we need to build a little better values. As I told, the first word, attitude, how to create positive attitude towards life. I think when you build positive attitude towards life, automatically rest everything is opposite to that.
Mm.
I think be it any, not only in the education field, beyond education.
Beyond education.
He goes to work, he goes into family life, goes into parenthood. Everything reflects there.
Mm. So what do you think, Mr. Shankaran?
I subscribe to George. I mean, I was just having a discussion the other day in one of the conferences with a psychologist,
mm-hmm.
who was a child psychologist. You know, what he was basically telling us today, when you have a nuclear family and you know you have one child and maximum two child, and there's a lot of attention between that to that one child.
Correct.
From both the parents.
Yeah.
You don't allow a child to fall down.
Mm.
You don't allow a child, because in the learning age, I believe, you know, there are a lot of stages where certain fundamental qualities are built in children through a natural process. They run around in the field, they go fall down, they network with kids, they fight, they learn some basic skills at that very, very young age.
Yes.
Today, you don't let this child go out and play. You give them a mobile device and tell them, sit and, you know, whatever play you want to do, do it over here. You don't allow a child to crawl on the floor. Cushion there for the child.
That's
to.
True.
So you are basically nurturing them and not really preparing them for a real world.
That's
the extensions
right.
of that come in the higher education.
True.
It showcases as a big problem there, because they have come into a very, very nurtured environment where they have not been told to stand on your own legs and fight the world and face the realities of life. They have only been shown the good part of it and groomed only with the good part of it. They have not really, really grown. So I think certain things, while we are disrupting the world and creating a new world and new skills and things like that, these certain elements needs to be firmly there to really create those skills, and we should not miss that growing
essence.
Those
yeah.
things need to be kept intact. While the other technology
and
things like that can happen.
No. Yeah, completely endorse that, because earlier it was by chance that we all had to go through the lives we had to go through, but which made us what we are.
Yeah.
Today there is a choice, and sadly, as an anticlimax, the same parents who went through this scenario today is on the other opposite, other side, you know, where they are wanting their students to be very protected, their children to be very protected, unlike themselves, who never had all this, cushions all over.
Seven kids is there in the family.
Yeah, exactly.
Individual attention. Now you have one child, and you want him to be a Bharatanatyam dancer, and a cricket player, and an academic, high performer. There's a lot of parental pressure and a lot of guidance which are spoon-fed into that child. Children are put through that tough expectations to be matched.
True.
I think you are actually taking the child out of the child when they are in their children.
True, very true. So thank you so much. We will come back again.
Thank you. We thought we will have a first
session like this. And these are things why we, the whole idea of Shades itself is to bring the essence of non-curated thoughts. Okay. The idea is because these, candid discussions and these candid thoughts would trigger somewhere something with somebody listening to it or somebody seeing this. Today, information overload is the most important problem what we face.
Yeah.
Right? But that, it's like saying the population explosion. 15, 20 years back in India, it was considered to be very disastrous. Today, that's our strength.
Yeah.
So same way, information explosion is also a problem for us. But that, even if a small minuscule percentage converts into knowledge, then we are going to have empowered lives all over. I think that's why we thought we'll have this as a web series every week, one, and mainly for youth, children, all of them. But then at least once a month, we thought we'll go through these senior level sessions so that we can at least try and express our thoughts, which can be, kind of understood. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, and looking forward. Yeah.